From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Karen Lasser, Professor of Medicine at Boston University and Senior Editor at JAMA. Today, I am joined by Dr. Aileen Chang, who is an Associate Professor of Dermatology at the University of California, San Francisco. Welcome, Dr. Chang, to this JAMA podcast.
Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure. To begin with, how common are infestations with scabies, bedbugs, and lice, and what are some of the risk factors?
These ectoparasites that you just mentioned, scabies, bedbug, and body lice infestations, are pretty common. Unfortunately, we don't have fantastic epidemiology data for all of the ones that you mentioned, but where we have the strongest data is for scabies. And we know that in 2021, there were approximately 622 million incident cases of scabies globally. And that prevalence is highest in low and middle income tropical countries and among children in these regions. In high income countries, we also see sporadic cases and outbreaks in institutions. And so, for example, like in nursing facilities, shelters, carceral settings, childcare settings, even sometimes hospitals. And then, you know, for bedbug infestations, we don't have great data, unfortunately, for the epidemiology, but we know that since the late 1990s, there seems to have been globally a resurgence in bedbug infestations due to increased urbanization, international travel, and insecticide resistance. And then for body lice, we think about body lice in persons who are unable to maintain personal hygiene. So most commonly for us, that would be thinking about people who are unhoused. Also, we can think about displaced populations globally who don't have access to washing facilities. And then there are a minority of patients who get body lice infestations because they have mental illness, cognitive impairment, or physical disability. And because of those, they also have unmet needs for their activities of daily living. And so they're not able to wash themselves regularly. And so we know that among persons experiencing homelessness, the prevalence of body lice ranges from 4.1% to 35%. And that's coming from studies that have occurred around the world. And then the other part of your question was about risk factors. And so for scabies, the way that scabies is transmitted is through direct skin-to-skin contact. So the major risk factor is being in a crowded setting. Another one is when sort of that direct skin-to-skin contact is happening frequently, so in caregiver settings. And then people who are sharing a bed or living in close quarters, and then also through sexual contact. So again, the common thread there is that there's that direct skin-to-skin contact. And then for bedbug infestations, you can sort of have increased suspicion for this when people have been in a lodging facility with high turnover, so hotels, motels, shelters.
My next question is, what made you decide to cover these three conditions in particular in the same review?
That's a great question. I think a lot of it is coming from the clinical experience that our group was having with evaluating ectoparasitic infestations and thinking about what is on our clinical differential diagnosis. And, you know, I think it all came from a place of wanting to help clinicians better tease out these different infestations. And, you know, scabies is, we don't have great epidemiology data for all of the ectoparasitic infestations, but scabies is certainly common. And then a question that we often get is the scabies, and oftentimes it's, sometimes it is, sometimes it's not. And when it's not, we are thinking about bed bugs, we're thinking about flea bites, mosquito bites, biting flies, we think about avian and rodent mite infestations. There's many other ectoparasites that can cause itchy rash, and we couldn't cover all of them in this review. So we focus on bed bugs as one of the biting organisms that we think about. And then body lice infestation, I think some of this is influenced by where our group practices on the West Coast, and body lice infestation comes up a lot in the differential, and we frequently see it misdiagnosed as scabies, and with unfortunately the growing prevalence of homelessness in the United States, we thought it was an important condition to highlight and bring to the forefront.
Yeah, so to summarize, it's that these three conditions should be high on the differential for kind of an itchy body rash, correct?
Yes. Yes. And then something we go into our review about is using history data, including social drivers of health, to help you order that differential.
Now, how do patients present with scabies?
One of the most challenging things about scabies is that it can present in many different ways. And so I want to first off acknowledge that, and that it's also challenging for dermatologists to know whether or not it's scabies. So the classic presentation of scabies is, I think about the distribution on the body. So we think about hands, wrists, web spaces, and sort of the corollary there, feet, web spaces, and ankles. We know that from work that was done during World War II by Kenneth Mellenby, that's sort of now just part of common knowledge and isn't really even cited, that those locations, hands and wrists, are the locations for about 60% of where scabies lesions are. So I'm always looking there first if I have scabies in my differential, and that's pretty easy to evaluate in a patient that you're seeing. And then other places that we can see lesions, and I'll talk about what the lesions look like in a moment, but other places that we see them include around the umbilicus, in the axilla, in the neck, in the genital region, and also the areola. And then in terms of what the lesions look like, the most common are these small papules. They're about 2 to 3 millimeters, so pretty small, clustered in the areas that I just talked about. But we can also see nodules. And then we can also see little tiny vesicles. And then what you hope to find to really kind of secure or feel confident in your diagnosis are burrows. And burrows are these really small thread-like lesions. They're only about 0.5 millimeter, so like super small in width. And their length is like 3 to 7 millimeters. And that's actually where the mite is. But in common scabies, there's not that many mites on the body, so it can be hard to find these burrows. But sort of the best place to look for them are the hands and the wrists. And so the challenging thing, though, is that because it can take several weeks for this sort of hypersensitive reaction to develop, and then by the time someone comes into your clinic, things can look differently. So these papules can become excoriated. So like they're sort of, you know, people have scratched because they're really itchy. And so you lose that morphology you're looking for. And then because they've been scratching so much, they've developed these eczematous plaques. And that can sort of start to confuse the picture. And then you start to wonder if it's something else. And so that's part of what makes scabies really challenging to diagnose.
And what is first line treatment for scabies? And why does pruritus persist in patients after treatment for scabies?
First-line treatment for scabies is topical permethrin 5% cream, and it should be applied for at least 8 hours and upwards to 14 hours to all areas of the body from the neck to the toes in adults. And I tell patients you want to make sure you get it into every nook and cranny of your body, and then it's rinsed off. And importantly, it needs to be repeated in 1 to 2 weeks. And that's a really important point that I want to emphasize, because I think often that does not happen. And the reason why it's important is because permethrin cream is not ovicidal. And so that first application will take care of the adult mites, but then the eggs that have been laid down in the skin will hatch in the subsequent 1 to 2 weeks. And so that second dose is really important to make sure that those eggs that then hatched and became adult mites, that those mites are then also taken care of with the second application. And then the other first-line treatment that we use and that can be considered is oral ivermectin. And oral ivermectin, I think there are some advantages to it and also disadvantages as compared to permethrin. But I'll tell you, so with ivermectin, the dosing is 200 micrograms per kilogram, and I always round up. These are available in 3-milligram tablets in the U.S., and it's two doses, again, 1 to 2 weeks apart, because ivermectin is not ovicidal, so you need to do the second dose to kill the eggs that became mites. And I think one advantage of ivermectin is that it doesn't require topical application as an oral medicine. And so we have used this when we have patients who are in a position where they can't apply topical medicines, maybe because they don't feel comfortable, they don't have privacy, or they don't have access to clean running water to kind of wash off the creams, or they have an underlying condition like eczema, and applying permethrin cream, which can cause an irritant contact dermatitis. We want to avoid that for them because we don't want to trigger or flare their underlying eczema.
Thank you. Now on to bedbugs. How do people develop problems with bedbugs, and how do they present?
Bedbugs are in the environment, and so they're looking for a blood meal to finish their life cycle, and that's why they're coming to bite humans, and they bite at nighttime. What happens is that people, they may be in the environment that someone is in, usually unbeknownst to that person, and so that might be in the hotel room or motel shelter, or unfortunately even like in an apartment that they've moved into. And then bedbugs are really good at hitching a ride on anything. And so they end up in the luggage, and they end up in the mattresses. They can be even be in the walls and the furniture. So they really get into wherever they can in the environment. And then they're coming out to bite.
And how do patients present with bedbugs?
So the most common presentation for bedbugs is this breakfast, lunch, dinner sign, which is basically this linear, in a line, an array of these red to pink papules that are very itchy. Commonly, but not always, the people report that the new skin lesions, that they saw them when they woke up. And that makes sense because we know that bedbugs bite at night. But and then the degree of the reaction that somebody has to bedbugs ranges. So some people can have these smaller papules, but others can really get these large, like hive-like urticarial plaques. And then a tip off to have you think about that someone's biting and versus just having like urticaria or hive reactions to something else is that in the center of, usually it's the center of the lesion, you might see like a small 1 to 2 millimeter vesicle. It might have been scratched off, so you'll see an excoriation there. Or it might have been scratched so hard that it actually just looks like a hemorrhagic punctum, like a little blood dot in the middle. And that can be a sign that something is biting this person. It might be bedbugs.
And what precautions should travelers take when visiting hotels and alternative accommodations to identify or avoid bedbugs?
That's a great and important point because we want to prevent these infestations. So individuals can carefully inspect their new environment and their luggage. And if they've bought used furniture or other household items, they should isolate it and examine it before they integrate it into their household.
Thank you. And how should bedbugs be treated?
So there's two components to the treatment of bedbugs. One is the symptoms, like people are really uncomfortable, they're really itchy, and we like to use a mid-potency topical corticosteroid like triamcinolone. And usually that's enough, but sometimes people need something stronger so we can escalate in that situation to something with higher potency like fluocinonide or clobetasol even. Occasionally people need antihistamines or even gabapentin to help, so basically oral antipruritic agents to help, but usually not. And then the hardest part about treatment is eradication. And I don't want to minimize how difficult this can be for people who have a bedbug infestation. And it really requires professional pest management services to use an integrated strategy to get rid of bedbugs. And we know that this can be cost prohibitive for some patients, some families, and this is really is a challenge. And for some patients, this also gets into positions where they're asking their landlord or requesting that these services to get done, and there's pushback. And so it brings in a lot of layers, and I think it's part of what makes this having a bedbug infestation so challenging and also just so distressing for our patients.
Sure. Now, last but not least, we have body lice. Could you describe how patients typically present with body lice?
The physical exam can really help you here. So body lice, the key is the distribution of the lesions. And the lesions themselves are often very nonspecific. They can look like eczema, excoriations. And so the lesions themselves, sometimes hives and blisters, but the lesions themselves don't necessarily tell you it's body lice. It's really where they're located. So because body lice live on clothing and they're coming off the clothing to get a blood meal on the nearby skin, they like to be along clothing seams because it serves as a track for them to kind of run along. And so if you want to think about where are clothing seams coming into contact with the body, and so where we'll see these lesions is typically in those locations. So that's the upper back and shoulders, the waistline, the lateral trunk, we'll see it along the medial thighs and legs, and then the ankles. And notably, when it, on the back, you'll see the sparing of the central back. And again, it could look like excoriations, eczematous lesions, hyperpigmentation, but it's really the distribution of where those findings are. And then if you're thinking about body lice, then you want to examine the clothing as well to look for the lice and the nits.
Could you discuss treatment and prevention?
People get a body lice infestation because they're unable to maintain personal hygiene. So what that basically means is that they're unable to clean their body, which, you know, if we just take a moment, that's a sad situation that we're talking about that's happening in the US and other countries around the world. So the prevention of body lice is bathing at least once a week and laundering of clothing and bedding at least once a week in hot water and using high heat drying. So treatment is also that. So getting a bath to the individual who bath or shower, you know, cleaning their body who has the infestation, and then also laundering of their clothing and bedding. I mean, practically speaking, a lot of times the clothing or bedding might just be disposed of, and trying to get that individual new clothing is often what will happen.
Thank you. Now, over the years, I have had patients bring in a bug in a little Ziploc bag. So my question is, which of these three are visible with the naked eye, and could one conceivably bring it into the doctor?
That is always a fun experience to have. So two of these that we've talked about are visible to the naked eye, the unaided eye. So bedbugs and body lice. Bedbugs are larger in size than body lice. You could think about that if you're actually able to see an isolated organism.
Terrific. Thank you. Now, is there anything else generalists should know about scabies, bedbugs, and body lice that we haven't talked about?
I think the most important thing that I want to encourage is that clinicians recognize that there's a broad differential even within ectoparasites and things that can bite patients. That certainly we think about what the more common things, but there are also other entities. And I think our article in one of the boxes goes into a lot of detail about some of the other types of ectoparasites to consider. And then I also want to emphasize again that this can be very challenging to figure out what is biting a patient. And it takes a lot of time and resources, sometimes which are not available to the patient to be able to really figure out what's going on. But I think the main thing I want to say is that this can be challenging, and that also there are other ectoparasitic infestations beyond just scabies and bedbugs to think about.
Thank you so much. This has been tremendously helpful. I'm Dr. Karen Lasser. I've been speaking today with Dr. Aileen Chang from the University of California, San Francisco, about scabies, bedbugs, and body lice. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. Thanks for listening.